So, sorry for those who have already heard the beginning, but I introduce myself once more. So I'm here as a president of the Malagasy Private Sector Humanitarian Platform, but I'm also the executive director of Action Foundation, former Telema Foundation, who had a key role in the establishment of the private sector humanitarian platform. So in Action Foundations, we are develop and support a philanthropic project for the entire group in its five activity clusters: telecom, energy, finance, real estate, and innovation. And those not only for Madagascar, but also for Togo, Senegal, Comoros, Réunion Island. We support and address projects dealing mainly with education, health, environment, sustainable development, humanitarian actions, and community development. I have to share with you. Okay. So as you may know, Madagascar is a huge island, but isolated from the African continent. And despite its wealth of natural resources, Madagascar is the third country most subject to climate change impacts, more especially to cyclone and floods, but also terrible and recurrent droughts in the south. Consequently, the risk and disaster management and humanitarian emergencies are main issues for our country. And in Madagascar, many private companies are very active in social activities, but most of them do not know or did not know what the humanitarian issue is, or don't know how to be efficient and to be sure to respond to the real needs. And as we were preparing for WHS, so it was the World Humanitarian Summit, occurred in 2016 in Turkey, many companies have clearly expressed their willingness to collaborate on the humanitarian issues. We decided then to create the platform, the Private Sector Humanitarian Platform, in December 2014. And then we have structured as an association in 2017. And this platform, considered at that time as a pilot project worldwide, aimed to facilitate the private sector support for humanitarian needs in coordination with traditional humanitarian actors and government, and also to promote corporate social responsibilities. It also endeavors to increase the involvement and effectiveness of private sector in risk reduction, preparedness, and response, as well as to optimize the use of existing services, equipment, financial and technical resources, and not only money. The private sector is often forgotten in the upstream phases of the risk and disaster management cycle, but the sooner companies would take part of the process and the more confident they will be and help more efficiently government and traditional humanitarian actors. So PSHP is led by and also treasurer, secretary, and four committees, four thematic committees: communication, CSR, health, and task force. The bureau is elected every 2 years, and the last elections took place in June 2019, so 1 year ago exactly. The health committee here is new and was created after the plague and the measles epidemics. At that time, in 2018, we conducted several workshops to take advantage of the lessons learned and provide to our members a set of best practices in case of epidemics, because it was quite new in Madagascar and it was even not taken into account in the contingency, in the national contingency plan, or at least not very well. And we didn't know yet of the hard job we will have to face a few years later with the fight against COVID-19. So the PSHP is fully part of the humanitarian team. Indeed, addition to the thematic committees conducted between members and from partners, We have at least one of our members in each humanitarian clusters attending the different meeting all year long, either during the preparedness phase or during the other phase of the DRM cycle. Thanks to UN OCHA and CBI support, we have first developed some products to help our members to be prepared, well-informed, and ready to respond in case of disasters. Firstly, we have conducted work sessions with our members and the methodological support of UN OCHA and BNGRC. BNGRC is the National Bureau of Disaster and Risk Management. And as a result, we have developed a private sector contingency plan in coherence with the national one and a joint business continuity plan. Secondly, we have conducted the mapping of private sector members' capacities to help humanitarian clusters to know what is available from the private companies and so to have a more efficient response. So you see on the map, and we have identified where, so it's not very easy to see, but we have identified in each region where are localized our members and what they can provide as, for example, transportations, logistics, or products, services, and so on. And finally, we have developed a collaborative web portal that mainly enables a public access to share information on risk and disaster management and on the members, the organization, and the achievements of the platform. And also a private access for members, and which also allowed organizations from the clusters to share documents, meeting agendas, and allowed cluster leaders to send instant help messages for specific and urgent needs in order to be as quick as possible in the response by involving all the private sector members. And we have produced all these tools at the very beginning of the adventure, and we review and update them each year, for example, during the lesson learned sessions. We could classify our contributions in four areas: emergency response, training and capacity building of our members, strategic partnerships with national or international NGOs, or UN agency and government, and social commitments through CSR projects and social actions all over the year. So you can see on this timeline some of our most representative responses to the different kind of disasters we encountered in Madagascar this past 6 years. So as you see, it's mainly cyclones and drought in the south of Madagascar, but also great floods and epidemics like measles and plague, and of course COVID-19 this year. I won't enter into the details, but you can see that we had several ways of participating, either through fundraising and then buying the products needed and proceed to the distribution, because we are involved from the beginning to the distribution, or directly give products, service of capacities needed to population or people acting on the field. So that is companies who have products or services to share and to provide. But in any case, we are always starting from the needs coming from the National Bureau of Disaster Risk and Risk Management, or authorized coordinate or as efficient as possible, and to act complementary to the other organizations and avoid duplication and people left behind. To illustrate our second area of contribution, so that means training and capacity building, we could mention the establishment of local focal points in Madagascar regions. So we have at least most risky regions with focal points, and these focal points allow us to enhance our awareness towards local situations and respond more quickly to the local needs. They are very valuable information sources also for all the humanitarian actors, and they are also able to leverage our actions locally. We have also conducted some trainings with the help of our humanitarian partners, and so minimize the gap of comprehensions between these two worlds, two different worlds, humanitarian and business. And additionally, we conducted some workshops in order to update our contingency plan and our business continuity plan, and also participate to simulation exercises with all the humanitarian actors. On a regional scale, and once again, thanks to the support of CBI, we have conducted some workshops and meetings with several companies, institutions, and business organizations, mainly in Mauritius, but also in Comoros, to think about an opportunity to build a regional platform, PSHP Indian Ocean. This idea is still pending and could be reactivated thanks to our commitment in the UNGC local network. On an international scale, lastly, we also have to mention the great support and the great interest to be a part of the CBI, and so have access to a lot of valuable resources shared either from other countries or directly from the CBI team itself. Through this network, we also have the opportunity to share our own experience and reinforce our knowledge through training, webinars, etc. And last but not least, CBI proposes also some financial support to develop valuable projects and to enhance our efficiency. And we also have the opportunity to participate in international events like the WHA in 2016, and every year since 2017, we participate to the annual Humanitarian Networks and Partnerships Week in Geneva. And it's really the opportunity to share with other platforms or practices and experiences, and it's really, really important. To end this general presentation of on the private sector humanitarian platform, I would like to highlight in this slide some reasons why this kind of platform involving the private sector in the entire cycle of disaster risk management is clearly an opportunity for the government, traditional human actors, and of course for the private sector itself. And that this approach is a real strength for a better efficiency in humanitarian action. So for our members, private companies and groups, it allows to have a better understanding of the humanitarian world and how to help for a better efficiency. It is also to enhance their CSR, because sometimes they don't have enough resources to build a real CSR. It helps also to respond to emergencies, and not only with money, but also by sharing and providing their own products, services, competencies. It's often easier to share this than give money. And not only be a part of the response, but also part of all the cycle and especially preparedness together with all the traditional humanitarian actors and the government. For the government and traditional humanitarian actors, it's an opportunity to sign MOU and PPP to be better prepared in case of emergency, and so have access to relevant capacities, products, services more promptly. And have other sources of reliable information from the field, because companies are based all over the country. It's also the opportunity to develop new patterns, or better, more coordinated distribution of humanitarian aid. Maybe some questions before beginning the second part of my presentation about COVID-19. I don't know if there is some question. No, so I go. Yes. I don't have access to the question, so I have to look at my collaborators. Okay. When you talk about private sector members of PSHP, how representative is it? Let's consider SMEs or traditional, or may I say local entrepreneur. So no, we have every kind of representative. So we have very small companies, SMEs, and we have also big group like Action Group. I mentioned that it's a Pan-African group. And we have also international group, but with a representation in Madagascar. So it could be so everything. And we have also NGOs from a big group, for example, in Vanilla and so on. So everyone is accepted. I just go back to my first slide. This one, yeah. So it's a new one. The only criteria is that you have to be based or represented in Madagascar. PCP has addressed this question before, but has the colleagues been different now in the current case? How? So for the COVID-19, I will go through my the second part of my presentation, maybe. Okay. Okay, so let's start. So for the COVID-19, you can see on this slide some key dates for Madagascar. I won't go through the details, but I would like to highlight the role of PSHP and then to answer to the question of Tina. What was the role of PSHP during these pandemics? As you can see, first of all, in March 18, we have decided to provoke a meeting between private sector, even companies not yet members of the platform, all the private sector, we have a large invitations, and WHO and UN OCHA to inform about this pandemic, even before the first cases have been confirmed in Madagascar, because at that time, we had a lot of information, real or fake, coming from the rest of the world, and companies were quite anxious on the best way to act for the safety of the collaborators, and the continuity of their businesses. And as the pandemic grew in the country, we coordinate our members' contribution with the help of our local focal points, always involving CCO, so the Operation Command Center, and WHO and or the Ministry of Public Health. And we were and we still are relaying information, support, guidelines for private companies coming from UN agencies, CBI or other sources. And we also help to obtain authorization from the Operational Command Center and relay the needs coming from them. So we are really a relay between the CCO and the private sector. The situation here in Madagascar is today officially 10 deaths and 1,272 confirmed cases with 367 cured, maybe thanks to the COVID organics. You know, you should know about the Malagasy natural remedy distributed by our president to many countries in Africa. So we will see if it's interesting. Okay, so additional to the first meeting with WHO and UN OCHA, I just mentioned, we have also supported the government and WFP, leader of the logistic humanitarian cluster, to organize an emergency meeting about telecom issues. It was we all know how communication is important of emergency, and government and WFP wanted to ensure the participation of all the telecom companies in to struggle to fight this crisis. And being part of the CBI, we had the chance to participate in webinars to share and receive information on what has been done in other countries through other platforms. Moreover, WhatsApp group allows us to instantly exchange documentation, information, or best practices that we also share here to our members. So the role of PSHP is clearly central, relaying the needs of BNGRC and the CCO and other partners to and then coordinate the individual and collective response of all members. In the next two slides, I have listed the main contributions from PSHP members, either individually or together with the platform. In terms of telecom supplies, it's mainly Telmat, telecom company member of PSHP, who has contributed for an equivalent of $200,000, providing telecom equipment, optical fiber, internet connections to the CCO here in Tana and also in the regions, data and voice credits, and also call centers, call center services, because we, the government put in place two emergency lines to be able to answer to concerns from people. Also, several members contributed by donated food, either by directly donating their own products or buying the products needed, for an amount of more than $245,000. In terms of medical supplies, we have a lot of members, thanks to our health committee. We have a lot of members, pharmacists or wholesalers, who have donated a lot of medicines and medical supplies. And some of our members have also bought some individual protection equipment and medicines, and for an amount of approximately more than $600,000. Also contributed to logistics, sanitary and wash supplies. In terms of impact, we have also worked with local NGOs and French people who have developed a small illustrated book to explain what is the COVID-19 and raise kids' awareness on the virus, showing them the right behavior and even giving them a tutorial on how to make a mask by themselves. And I'm very happy to inform you that this small book is available not only in Malagasy, of course, but also in English, in French, Spanish, Italian, Polish, and Swahili, and that we are ready to share the files with any of those who are interested in. It's a very simple a book and illustrated and very, very interesting for children. We will give also the files to CBI, and we will try to let them available on the portal. Two last examples of how the private sector can support institutions in preparedness and response to pandemics is illustrated with the last project granted by the CBI. We are working on one side with the Ministry of Transportation to develop a contact tracing system to be used for passengers using the buses to travel in the country. And on the other side, in parallel, to upgrade the mapping of capacities of our members to identify what should be available for response to pandemics. So in the first project, so for the contact tracing system, the contact tracing system will be able to collect relevant data to facilitate the research for potential contaminated people in case of the discovery of a confirmed case during a travel. Our support is the development, the installation, the training, and involving institutional partners. The second one is private sector capacity mapping for pandemics. So we have developed a tool to help data collection and then conduct data analysis before updating the mapping of capacities with the relevant data for response to by presenting our members, who are, as you see, from various business areas. So we have companies from bank and insurance, mining industry, telecom, food and beverage, transportation and logistics, health services, energy, hotel and catering, and so on. and also some of our partners. And I thank you all and hope this presentation was not too long and gave you a good overview of the private sector humanitarian platform in Madagascar and how important is the involvement of the private sector to enhance humanitarian aid efficiency. I will also provide a link to a 5-minute video illustrating the Malagasy context and the creation of the platform. This video was made for the WHS in 2016, but it's nice to see if you have 5 minutes. And if you have some questions or if you want more information, feel free to ask or to contact me later by email or by social network. Thank you very much. There is a question. Are you already established or even implemented any strategies to support the private sector, especially for tourism, hotel, or post-COVID context? Ah, it's a big question. The problems, yes, we don't have addressed this problem at the moment because it's already, so I think you are here in Madagascar. And so you know that GEM, the groupment of enterprise, Malagasy enterprise here, is trying to have some meetings with the president, and it's not so easy to have. So we are not part of this, so directly part of this discussion yet. But we will we'll stay available to help if needed. But at the moment, we don't address this issue. I don't know if there is more. Okay, I don't know if there are other questions. Okay, so I don't know, Tina, how. And go here. Okay. And stop. Okay. J'entends rien, moi. I don't know if someone is speaking because I don't hear anything. So, no? Ah, Tina has a question. What has been the most inspiring experience or achievement for you when working with the platform? Wow. we meet people and companies that are very interesting in participating to humanitarian aid and don't know how to do. And it's very interesting to see that we help for that and that thanks to the platform and the job made by my collaborators and the bureau, we can give more efficient support for humanitarian aid, and we can help also governments and UN agencies, and we are recognized as now as very important actor on the in the humanitarian team, and so it's very a real good achievement. And also that thanks to the platform and thanks to the this better help coming from the private sector, we should address more needs in communities, and it's a good benefit for populations. So this is an achievement, a good achievement. I don't know if there are some more questions. Okay, thank you all. So as I mentioned, I will give available the link for the video and for the files for the Corona book. So thank you everyone, and have a nice day.